Next, I'd like to introduce Dr. Jonathan Feddock. He earned his medical degree from the University of Kentucky College of Medicine and completed an internship and residency at UK, where he served as chief resident for his final year. He completed additional training in pediatric radiation oncology at St. Jude's Children's Research Hospital in Nashville, Tennessee. And Dr. Feddock serves as chair of the Markey Cancer Center Research Audit Committee and is a member of the Data Safety and Monitoring Committee. He's an elected member of the Radiation Oncology Committee for the Gynecologic Oncology Group, serves as site primary investigator for cooperative group trials, and is the principal investigator of a phase one trial for recurrent breast cancer. Dr. Feddock is also becoming well known in the fundraising arena. He created the Ironcology campaign. It's a unique fundraiser that combines his talents for racing Ironman distance triathlons with cancer care. Please welcome Dr. Feddock.
All right. Thank you for that introduction. I wasn't quite expecting that. And thank you for the organizers for actually asking me to come and give this talk. I titled it Update from the Underground because if you look at the nice, beautiful picture of the Markey Cancer Center, and if you look over here in the corner, there's a nice garden there with a little radiation sign on it that says keep off. And that's basically guarding where I live, which is in the basement of the Markey Cancer Center. So most of the time, I don't even know if it's raining, snowing, or what it's like outside, but we do have one skylight in our department, which every now and then we can kind of get a glimpse. So mostly what I'm talking about kind of comes from whatever we do in the radiation medicine department, and specifically I'm focusing on some ways that we can benefit some of the outreach centers that are throughout the rest of the state, and specifically our affiliate networks, how we can benefit you. So the objectives from my talk are mainly to review some of the radiation oncology services and the innovative treatments that we have available here. I'll touch on stereotactic body radiation therapy, helical tomotherapy, gamma knife radiosurgery, advanced brachytherapy, and then something new called SIR-SPHERES, radioembolization. We'll learn about some of the currently active clinical trials that we have open here at UK, and then I got a slide devoted on how to get your patients to us and how to communicate with us at the end. So our department is pretty much split between two centers, at least for the radiation oncology department. We have kind of the Chandler Center here, where there's five faculty. Our chairman is Mark Randall. Our vice chair is Mahesh Kudramodi. Dr. Randall's known fairly well for his gynecologic cancer treatments. Dr. Kudramodi does all of our head and neck, upper GI, and sarcoma. Ronald McGarry is our chair of research, and he's also pretty active in phase one, phase two trials. He does all of our stereotactic program in lung cancer. William St. Clair focuses on genitourinary and CNS tumors, and then I'm on the end, as Sherry mentioned, I do breast, gynecologic, and pediatric cancers. We also have a satellite facility, which is in Moorhead at the St. Clair Regional Medical Center, and there we have Dr. Pushpa Patel and Dr. Robin Reams that split the services. Now, for the UK proper, we have five full-time physicians, five full-time medical physicists. We actually have three training programs in our department. We have a medical residency. We have a medical physics program, which is the sixth oldest medical physics program in the country. But we have both a master's program and a residency program. So we do benefit a lot from having some advanced physics education programs here. We have four full-time dosimetrists and 10 full-time radiation therapists, and our average caseload is about 80 to 90 patients per day. So we have five main treatment units that we rely on when we actually do radiation therapy. I always like to look at the machines with their covers off because it actually tells you how many moving parts make up a radiation machine. But this is what's called the Varian True Beam. This was just installed last year in February. And this is pretty much the most advanced radiation machine that you can purchase right now. And we actually had the first one that's the slimline model installed in the U.S. was actually put here. But some of the benefits of this are there's a microleaf collimator, which is a fancy word that means we can make very complex shapes and treatments. It has onboard imaging capabilities so that we can do live CT scans while we're doing treatments to verify we're treating the right area. And then it allows us to do all the advanced treatment options. So kind of here's just a little schematic kind of explaining what this is allowed to do. Most older radiation machines were kind of what we call point and shoot. They point at the patient, they shoot a beam, then you rotate it to the next patient, or next position and it shoots another beam. So it's very rudimentary. Well, this one can actually do a continuous arc all the way around the patient, and it allows us to do something called volumetric modulated arc therapy, where it doesn't have to treat the whole tumor at any point of that whole arc. So the machine's completely rotating around. Now, the typical style of treatment, as I mentioned, would be park in a position, shoot a beam, do another one. This allows us to treat in a complex circle. So the end result is, rather than having big, broad beams passing through the patient, you can central the dose exactly to where you want. Less side effects for the patient, and it's actually a much faster treatment altogether. Now, tomotherapy is another machine that we have. This one we installed in 2009. It's kind of pretty elegant looking. That's what the whole machine looks like, but it's a CAT scan on a rail. But the difference is it has a linear accelerator. So again, here's a picture with the whole machine taken off. I wish I had a video, because the entire unit rotates continuously. It's all on this big fixed ring with these enormous chains in the back that actually turn it. So what this allows us to do is treat something that's circular or spare something that's circular. So again, going back, this would be a treatment for a prostate cancer, where the normal style of doing this would be broad beams from the sides and the front. Instead, with the tomotherapy unit, we can treat it circular and make a nice round structure. So again, less side effects and a faster treatment for the patient. So we've been one of the most active Gamma Knife radiosurgery programs. Our first Gamma Knife unit was installed in 1992. We have what's called the Gamma Knife Perfection unit. That was installed in 2009. And this is a special brain treatment device that allows us to do a high dose of radiation specifically to the tumors of interest. So if you really want to have radiation appear exactly where you would like it in the brain, this is the type of machine that you need to do it in. We tend to treat about 5 to 7 patients per week on this unit. And then the last one is, if you know anything about me, and as Sherry mentioned, I came up with my own fundraiser last year. I pretty much devoted my last year of my life to actually getting an advanced brachytherapy suite. So hopefully sometime in the next year and a half, we'll have actually a CT on rails treatment suite that will actually allow us to do pretty much all advanced brachytherapy that you could ask for. Okay, so specifically talking about what are some of the treatment options and some of the kind of niche areas that I think we specialize here at UK, I'm going to touch in on each one of these aspects and talk a little bit about that. So stereotactic body radiation therapy is an advanced treatment technique that, rather than using large beams of radiation, it uses those machines that I just talked about to deliver multiple small treatment fields in order to give a very high dose of radiation to the exact area of interest. Specifically, this requires you're only treating the patient for 1 to 5 fractions. It does require patient immobilization, so we have this device called the body frame, where we actually lay the patient down on the treatment table. They have a vacuum bag that kind of immobilizes their whole body. It's like a bear hugger, so that when we set them up for treatment, they're not going to move. We push down on their belly so that their lungs are not moving very much. And what that allows us to do is really keep our volumes very small and basically get the sledgehammer out to get rid of the cancer. So this is what you're trying to do. And this is a patient with a lung cancer. And if specifically all you want to do is get a high dose of radiation right to the tumor and nowhere else in the rest of the body, this is the type of treatment that allows you to do it. So over the past decade, this has actually emerged as one of the recommended treatments for early stage lung cancer, specifically non-small cell lung cancer. It's supported by the NCCN guidelines as a preferred treatment for patients who are unable to undergo a lobectomy. There's a survival benefit that's been documented when we can actually get a high enough dose of radiation to where it's over the marker of 100 gray. And believe it or not, some of the early phase 1, phase 2 trials that were created to demonstrate this technique was feasible was done by Dr. McGarry when he was at Indianapolis. So one of the gems that we have here at UK that probably most people don't realize is we have one of the first 5 guys that kind of pioneered stereotactic radiation here at UK. So it's already fairly well established that that's a treatment that's well available around the US. But one of the areas that we've kind of excelled at is trying to push the envelope and incorporate that into other disease sites or other stages of cancer. So we were the first center that actually published data on using stereotactic in more advanced lung cancer. Now, if you're looking at locally advanced lung cancer, specifically your stage 3A or stage 3Bs, these patients have very poor survival outcomes. Published 5-year rates are only about 15-20%. Median overall survival is really about 1.5 years. And local control seems to be a very big factor for those patients, where 60 to 65 of them will be able to have local control, but that basically means 2 out of 5 are going to develop a local recurrence. There's been several trials done trying to look at dose escalation of radiation therapy. Single institution series look favorable, but when they've done it on large scale multinational trials, it doesn't really pan out. So our theory was that hopefully if we could actually incorporate stereotactic radiation, boost the dose of radiation of the primary tumor above that 100 gray mark that seems to be effective for stage one cancer, that might lead to an increase in overall survival. So we conducted our own phase one, phase two study. This completed in 2012, and I was actually the co-PI with Dr. McGarry, where what we did was we had 35 patients ranging from stage 2B to 3B non-small cell lung cancer. They had the standard chemoradiation therapy to 60 gray, and then we imaged them 1 month after their treatment with a PET scan. And any of the patients who had residual tumor at their primary site, we enrolled them on our clinical trial and actually did a stereotactic boost. So the goal was to boost anything that was left over. Now, if patients had a PET scan and there was a complete response, we actually did not treat those patients. We started out doing 10 gray, two fractions. That equivalent, by the math calculations, ended up being about 110 gray cumulative. But we had a couple patients who had some adverse toxicities that did not appear to be related to the treatment, but we later amended our protocol to 6.5 times 3, which brought the dose down to 102 gray cumulative. Our grade 3 toxicity rate was only 11.4%, and there was 83% local control rate in all the patients that we treated, which was about the highest that's been published in a large trial. So although it wasn't powered for survival, this was mainly a phase 1 trial looking at toxicity. It did appear that the improvement in local control may translate to improved outcomes, because the median overall survival for our stage 3A tumors was 24 months, and 30% of them are actually still alive today. And then, interestingly, all the patients who survived 12 months progression-free, they've remained without any active disease at a median follow-up of 30 months. So I do think, moving forward, that this may be a treatment option where if you can gain local control and you can prevent them from failing, they're going to do better in the long run. Now, some of the things that lends me to say that is that the regional lymph node failure rate, unfortunately, was 50%. And basically, a fifth of the patients who died of disease had no evidence of metastases. They all died from local regional progression. And then if you look at the patients that we screened that were not enrolled on the trial, 50% of them that had a complete clinical response at the end of treatment, they subsequently developed a local recurrence. So our next trial is actually going to be a phase one trial, where instead of boosting the primary tumor, this time we're going to be boosting the mediastinal lymph nodes. This trial is being written right now, and hopefully we're going to be pushing it through IRB in the next month. But we're going to take stage 2B, stage 3A, and stage 3B non-small cell lung cancer, just like before. They're going to get standard chemoradiation to 60 gray. And then the phase 1 component will be a dose escalation of mediastinal lymph node SBRT, concomitant with the primary site SBRT. We're going to begin at 3 gray times 3 fractions, which is a biological effective dose of about 90 gray. And the maximum dose is going to be 5.5 gray times 3, which equates to a biological effective dose of about 108. We have 6 dose cohorts that we're going to enroll on this trial. Once we figure out the maximum tolerated dose level, we're going to expand that and look at a progression-free survival, 18-month overall survival, and local regional control as our secondary endpoints. The idea that we would like to do with this trial is conduct a phase one here, and once that is open, try to expand this to some of the affiliate networks. We'll help train everyone in SBRT and hopefully get you guys to help us accrue to the phase two part of this trial. So just in conclusion, at least with regards to SBRT, it seems to be a safe and effective treatment modality for early stage lung cancer. I think its use and incorporation to locally advanced cancers on the horizon. And there's been actually very similar outcomes in many other disease sites, which is where this is expanding, within the spine, brain, liver, and then other well-selected patients with abdominal malignancies. All right, so one of the other areas that we tend to excel is re-irradiation. We do repeat radiation for a lot of sites, and it tends to be a lot of the patients are sent here, mainly because we have some of the more complex treatment machines. But at least some of the malignancies that I know for sure we do re-irradiation are breast cancer, gynecologic, head and neck cancer, brain and spine. And oftentimes we have multiple options for re-irradiation, which can range from interstitial brachytherapy, stereotactic radiation like we just talked, or actually hyperfractionated radiation. So with regards to breast cancer, this is kind of one of the areas that I'm a little bit passionate about, and I have a trial open for it. There's 30% of women will actually develop a local regional recurrence despite multimodality therapy. And due to concerns for increased toxicity, it's often not considered that re-irradiation is actually a possibility. When you look at one of the major trials that was published just last year, the CALOR trial, this was an international trial where what they did was they lumped results from three different groups, NSABP, British International Trial or Group, and then EORTC. But they actually looked at when you had a woman with a local regional recurrence and she received trimodality therapy, surgery, radiation, and chemo, about 88% of the time that woman was still alive 5 years down the road, compared to much less if you weren't able to add all treatments together. And survival outcomes for patients with unresectable recurrences are often much less. And sometimes the main reason to actually consider re-irradiation is not only that we have a potential for salvage and long-term durable options, but a lot of these women, when they develop a local regional recurrence, that's going to have a big impact on their quality of life. Now, previous radiation experiences using conventional radiation techniques have not had good outcomes. They've been tried to combine it with things like hyperthermia, and rates of toxicity are high, outcomes are mediocre. But there's some modern papers that have come out using IMRT, volumetric modulated arc therapy, that look like it's actually a much more acceptable treatment with acceptable toxicity and good outcomes when you can actually keep the cumulative dose high but less than this total dose of 120 gray. So the ideal thing that I'm trying to identify is that if a woman does have a dermal recurrence, we catch them early and prevent them from going to the right, which is a miserable quality of life for that woman. So some of the old ways of doing radiation, again, are using some of the broad radiation beams. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to recognize that this is going to cause a lot of toxicity when you treat the entire chest wall, several centimeters of lung, and often overlap with the heart. So more or less what we're trying to do now is use some of the advanced technology that we have to bend the dose of radiation around the chest wall, avoid a lot more of the lung, and specifically just retreat the area that we're doing. And I can do this actual technique to where I'm actually treating the skin and trying to avoid the ribs. So this is the other thing that we're also able to do. If you're worried about long-term heart disease, I can block out the LAD. It may not be reproducible every day, but I'm trying. All right, so we actually have a phase one study that's open right now combining re-irradiation for breast cancer with twice-weekly paclitaxel. I'm the PI on this as well as Dr. Romand. We opened this to accrual in August of last year. And what we're doing is we're re-irradiating women using our tomotherapy unit to a minimum dose of 50.4 gray. And the target when we do this is just in that picture I just showed you. It's actually the subcutaneous skin tissues up to the chest wall, trying not to treat the ribs, because ideally we're targeting those women with dermal recurrences. We're starting with twice-weekly paclitaxel. The theory behind that is that paclitaxel is probably one of the most potent radiation sensitizers and one of the most active agents for breast cancer. So our lowest dose cohort is 20 milligrams per meter squared, and we're escalating that up to 35 milligrams per meter squared. Since this is a phase one, our endpoint is maximum tolerated dose, but we're also looking at estimating toxicities, local regional control, and progression-free survival rates. Now, for whatever reason, I tend to be the re-irradiation guy at UK, so I also do a lot with gynecologic malignancies. Re-irradiation has actually been around a long time for gynecologic malignancies, but it's often not thought of for the same reasons of breast cancer. It's thought to be too toxic. But we know that radiation has a very solidified role in the management of gynecologic malignancies. And the unfortunate thing is when you have a woman that finishes cervical cancer treatment or uterine cancer treatment, and she develops a central pelvic recurrence, the whiplash response by the gynecologic oncologist is often a pelvic exoneration. If you've ever been involved with that surgery, you know what it entails. It's an extremely morbid procedure. Only about a third of the time can they actually complete the procedure. And the success rates are poor. Women have terrible quality of life afterwards. So for women with small volume recurrences, there is this old technique called interstitial radiation where you put in a permanent implant that will stay with them the rest of their life, but it gives radiation off over about a one-month time frame. My mentor, Mark Randall, started doing this 30 years ago, and it has worked tremendously. So this is actually a woman that, funny story, I gave a talk in Chicago last year at the American Brachytherapy Society meeting, and as I was giving a talk about interstitial radiation, the GYN oncologist in the group said, hey, I got a patient that I think may benefit from this. She was from New Jersey, and the talk was on Saturday. He had her booked for a pelvic exoneration on Tuesday. He told her about the talk. He sent me images by email, and she basically booked a plane ticket and flew to see me on Monday. This was her tumor right at the top of the vagina. This was a piece of cake, actually. She canceled her surgery. We booked her an implant the following week. We did a short course of radiation with some right cylinders. These are the implants that you can see right here. We basically put in these radiation seats directly into her cervix. I put them in. This is what her tumor looked like 1 week after. And then that was about 8 months ago. I saw her a month ago. That tumor's gone. She did not have to have a pelvic exoneration. But here's the nice thing about this type of treatment technique. Let's say my implant did not work. She's still a candidate for pelvic exoneration. I didn't burn any bridges. And because these radiation seeds only give radiation to about 5 millimeters away, there's no dose that's going to the sidewall. So she's actually fine if she needs to have a pelvic exoneration. So we saved her quite a bit of quality of life. So I've been involved with a couple different series of re-irradiation papers. Women used to love this because I tell them I'm going to give them gold because one of the radioisotopes we used was gold-198. That isotope actually had a much higher specific activity. Now what that means is I get a dose of radiation when I put the implant in. But we had a series of patients where we had average age was 76, median tumor volume. These are small tumors, 3 by 3.3 centimeters cubed. So, you know, we're only talking about the size of a quarter or so. But we had a 95% complete response rate, and 5 years, the local control rate was 63%. Now, recently, I started switching to this other isotope called cesium-131. This isotope is very similar to gold, but it has a lower specific activity, which means I get less radiation now when I do these implants. And last year, we published our results where I had 14 patients that we did a total of 17 implants in, and our local control was now up to 85%. And we only had 2 local failures. One of them was the largest tumor we did. We probably shouldn't have done it because it was going to fail anyways, but we bought her quite a bit of time before she needed a surgery. And the other one, we probably underdosed that tumor. We were able to re-implant it, and we got local control in that patient. At least in terms of prognostic factors, it seems like patients with cervical or vaginal tumors do better than the endometrial. Squamous cell cancers do better than adenos. Smaller tumor volumes obviously are going to benefit. The higher the radiation dose I can insert, the better the outcome. Permanent implants seem to do better than doing the more temporary implants, which require a several-day hospital stay. And then the other ones kind of look at some of the disease locations. And then the longer time frame it's been since their initial diagnosis, obviously the better. So 2 weeks ago, I was at American Brachytherapy Society meeting again, and I presented this data, which, since these implants seem to be so favorable and since they're only irradiating a small site, I've started incorporating them into the standard upfront management of gynecologic disease. Big picture is we haven't had any local failures, so that number really looks good. But the more important thing is by incorporating these, I've been able to reduce the dose of radiation that I'm actually delivering to things like the rectum, the small bowel, the bladder by anywhere from 20 to 60%. So this seems to be a very favorable type treatment response that can lead to durable outcomes in the well-selected patient. I do think it's a very good alternative to exonerative surgery, and as I mentioned, it doesn't really preclude them from undergoing surgery. And in a way, if I can do an implant and they don't develop a nodal recurrence in the next 6 months or the year, that probably selects them as the better patient, more likely to benefit in the event they needed an exonerative surgery. And then I do this, it's an outpatient procedure. They don't actually have to have general anesthesia, and they don't have to be admitted. All right, so the next topic is talking about liver primary tumors and metastases. Now, one of our newer junior faculty that's in surgical oncology, his name is Qingwei Zhang. He has done a lot of work with kind of bridging patients to hepatic resection or doing primary hepatic lobectomies, and it's actually a pretty exciting area. So if you look at the two main situations that we deal with for liver tumors, being primary hepatocellular carcinoma, you know that solitary tumors less than 5 centimeters, they tend to have an excellent prognosis. But those patients with multifocal disease or marginal hepatic function, the options are very limited and the outcomes are poor. Prognosis and treatment options almost tend to be completely related to the presence of portal vein thrombosis. And then if you look at the other population, colorectal liver metastases, about a third of them will have disease limited to the liver. And then selected patients, though, can have very good outcomes, as high as 60%. So the thing is, when you look at both of these groups, you've got very good actors for both of them. But then you also have small portions of them that, because they're not surgically resectable, the outcomes are terrible. So one of the focuses has been maybe trying to come up with good local treatments for both of these options that are going to take those unresectable patients and either make them resectable or make them have outcomes very similar. So radioembolization is a radiation technique that's actually combined with interventional radiology, where what we're trying to do is actually embolize and cut off the blood supply to the liver. But in doing so,
produce a radiation treatment. In general, radiation to the liver is something not well tolerated. The liver is large. It has a low tolerance for radiation. So spreading radiation around doesn't get you very far. But if you can do something focal, you can have a lot of road to what your treatment is. So there's three different radioactive isotopes that have been described for radioembolization. Yttrium-90 is probably the one that we use the most extensively. And at least in the past decade, that's the one that's kind of taken off as the main treatment. So it comes in glass or resin microspheres. We happen to use the resin spheres, which are what's called SIR spheres. These are 50 to 80 nanometers in diameter. And usually what we do is we inject about 40 to 80 million of them. We don't count them out by hand. They come in a vial and there's a concentration. But each sphere carries about 40 to 70 becquerel of Y90. So what that means is there's 2.7 times 10 to the 11th interactions per cell. Per second. So the half-life is about 64 hours. So when we send a patient home, what you can kind of anticipate is 1.5 times that is the time frame they're going to have their radiation treatment. So it ends up being about 5-day treatment. Now the penetration of these microspheres is only 2.5 to 10 millimeters. So the treatment doesn't go far. So collateral damage should be pretty small. So I'll just kind of walk you through this by going to the next slide. The way the procedure works is the patient has to come two trips to the angiography suite. The first trip to the angiography suite is pretty much a diagnostic angiogram with potential for embolization. So what they do is they bring the patient in, they do an angiogram, and they selectively get into the proper hepatic artery. So what you're seeing here is basically celiac trunk is right here. You have splenic artery going on the right, proper hepatic. This is a gastroduodenal branch. Here's the right hepatic, there's the left hepatic. So if they're going to embolize this, what you do not want is seeds going this way. We're going to radiate the spleen. Seeds going down here. We're going to radiate the stomach and the duodenum. So the first part of the procedure is let's go ahead and embolize that collateral so that we're not going to put seeds in there. There's plenty of blood supply to the duodenum. We're not going to hurt it. And then they actually make sure that they get the cannula passed enough so that there's no retrograde flow into the spleen. And when we can actually target the specific side of the liver that we're wanting to, they'll give a test injection of technetium-99, which is just a radio tracer. It's the same thing that we use for bone scans. As soon as that's done, they take the patient to the gamma camera down in nuclear medicine, and they measure the uptake that's in the lungs. If it's not too high, the patient's fine for treatment. If more than 20% of the tracer ends up in the lungs, we have to dose reduce just a little bit. And the dose reductions are basically right there. Okay, and then the dose of what we're doing based on the degree of liver involvement is on here on the bottom. So this is what the fancy container looks like, and one of the things I love is how nervous everyone gets whenever radiation's around and the NRC comes. But basically, we have this vial that's shaped like that. This is about the exact same size of a pager. I mean, it's about this big, but it'll come in a crate about this large that's full of lead weights and weighs about 100 pounds. But anyways, they bring this in. They do it all behind a lead shield, watching it under the camera. And basically, once they get the artery identified, they just slowly titrate some of this in over about a 5-minute period. So there has been some published data already out. If you look at the local regional treatment for primary hepatocellular carcinoma with multifocal or diffuse disease, so those are the patients not a surgical candidate, basically the median overall survival time without portal vein thrombosis tends to be about 10 months. For a patient unresectable who has no definitive treatment, overall survival tends to be about 4 months. So radioembolization for Child's Pugh A patients is actually very favorable. It's almost 17 months. For those with Child's Pugh B, it's about a 3-month improvement. Now, if you look at the patients who have Child's Pugh B and portal vein thrombosis, which is your worst group, we're still having them almost about a 6-month time frame. And the overall time of progression is about 8 months. It's also been compared to TACE, or transarterial chemoembolization. That's probably one of the other most common treatment techniques. This was a series published in 2011. There were higher objective response rates with radioembolization, as well as a longer time to progression. It was increased by almost 5 months. Overall survival is not really different, but one of the key things is whenever you do an embolization, there's this concept called a post-embolization syndrome, where a lot of patients tend to feel fatigue, tired, malaise, they can have elevated transaminases, and they get very nauseated. That's actually less or the symptoms are much less, shorter duration, less intensity when we do radioembolization compared to TACE. At least as far as liver metastases go, there's been two randomized trials that actually have compared it alone or with chemotherapy. The first one compared radioembolization compared to 5-FU. There was a significant increase in time to progression. Partial response rate was very high, 86% when you added it in. And this one, this series compared it with chemo alone versus chemo plus radioembolization, and the same thing. Much higher objective response rates and an improvement in overall survival. There was a SIRFLOX trial that was completed last year that compared 5-FU oxaliplatin with or without bevacizumab, with or without radioembolization. It was a 2x2 design. That trial's done. They keep saying results are coming in spring of 2015. They're running out of time. They should post it already. Okay. So at least for the role of radioembolization, it's already approved as a local therapy for unresectable hepatocellular carcinoma, colorectal liver mets, cholangiocarcinoma, and neuroendocrine tumors. It's emerging, though, as a bridge therapy for some of those patients to buy time until they can get on the transplant list for hepatocellular carcinoma, as a radiation lobectomy for potentially resectable lesions, and then a treatment for favorable metastatic breast cancer, pancreatic cancer, and possibly other primary tumors that have the single liver metastasis in the setting of metastatic disease. So at least one of the things that Ching-Wei Zhang has been a proponent for, which he received his training at MD Anderson, is this idea of doing a radiation lobectomy. This stuff's pretty impressive, but if you have a patient who has a very large right hepatic met, and let's say they also have a left lobe lesion, the idea that you can't resect that patient was kind of what's always been the thought, but maybe if you can decrease the right lobe, take it out, hypertrophy the left, then you'll have more liver present on the left that maybe you can go in and do a partial resection. Radioembolization kind of fits into that. So this is a picture of a patient on at the time of the angiogram. You can see they have a very large right hepatic mass. They actually have one on the left side too, but it's not imaged there. So this is a picture where they've actually, again, there's some embolization material in the gastroduodenal artery. They get into the right hepatic, inject the Sir's spheres. This is the pretreatment MRI, and then this is 3 months post. Give it another several months, and what happens is you'll actually see how now the right side of the liver is actually losing a significant amount of functionality. It's not taking up contrast the same as the left. And now look at how large the left lobe of the liver is. It's actually had time that it's compensated and hypertrophied. And then time of lobectomy, you can see the tumor that's actually in the pathologic specimen. Another 6 months later, maybe give the patient targeted therapy, they could undergo a partial resection on the left side. So I just have one slide on this. This is something that came out fairly new 2 years ago. When we have patients with metastatic prostate cancer or breast cancer that have primarily sclerotic bone mets, not lytic mets, there's always been the treatment that's been available, samarium. Samarium 153 is a radioactive isotope that's very similar to hydroxyapatite. So when you inject it in someone, it tends to go straight to the bone and gives off a radiation that actually can benefit patients with bony sites causing pain. So there was a new medicine that came out called radium-223. The other name for this is Zofigo. I'm always fascinated by the history of radiation in terms of all the bad things we learn by kind of dumb mistakes. So there's the old story of the radium watch dial painters that over 100 years ago, all these women, to paint the dials on watches, they'd take paintbrushes and paint them with radium so that they glowed. Well, the women always would lick the tips of the brushes to make them nice and sharp point when they painted the watches. Well, in turn, they were all getting a good dose of radium. And what they found was radium is bone-seeking, because if you look on the periodic table, you have calcium, and just below it is radium. It's bone-seeking. So all the women subsequently were developing osteosarcomas because they were getting secondary radiation. Well, this happens to be a perfect treatment for someone who has metastatic disease to bone, because the radium's going to go straight to the bony sites. So in 2013, this was approved by the FDA. It has a half-life of 11 days, and very interestingly, the treatment scheme for this is actually an alpha particle. An alpha particle is a helium nucleus. Helium doesn't really penetrate much, so it only goes about 2 or 3 millimeters deep from the site where it gets uptake. And the treatment for this is we give somebody one injection every 4 weeks for 6 cycles. It's an outpatient infusion. They come in 60 minutes, they're back out the door. The reason this was FDA approved was there was the Al-Simpka trial. Al is basically the other long medical name for Xofigo. Symptomatic prostate cancer was the rest of that acronym. But what they found was when they actually did this regimen and they compared it to placebo, they had almost 1,000 patients, there was a 44% improvement in overall survival. I will admit that's a relative improvement, but 14 months compared to 11 months, and the time to skeletal event to skeletal related event was almost 5 months longer when we used radium-223. Patients seem to tolerate it very well, and I think it's a good treatment. The current trial for breast cancer is ongoing right now, and hopefully that will be added to the FDA-approved list very soon. So in terms of the final additional therapies that are offered at UK, we're one of the only sites that does something called grid therapy, which is spatially fractionated radiation. This is very effective when you have a very large, bulky tumor. We've done grid therapies for head and neck cancer, gastrointestinal, and gynecologic. At least we're, in terms of prepping patients for transplant, we do a fair amount of total body irradiation. If we have a patient with mycosis fungoides or any of the other cutaneous T-cell lymphomas, total skin electron therapy is available. And then we actually have a very full range of equipment. We are probably one of the only centers in about a 500-mile radius who still have an orthovoltage unit that's very effective for treating skin cancers. So at least if you needed to get in touch with UK Radiation Medicine and you needed to discuss a patient with us or refer a patient to us or maybe even just get our opinion about one of your patients. Sorry, I didn't think to put my cell phone on here, Dr. Mullet. But our clinic mainline telephone number is 323-6487. I actually think the nurse's telephone sometimes is the best one because they'll answer it right away. And then, of course, if you needed to reach any of the physicians, we all respond to UKMDs fairly rapidly. So, all right, that's all I got. Any questions? Yes. I don't think that it's going to become standard of care because one of the problems that we've looked at with paclitaxel, there was an EORTC trial about 15 years ago where they actually did concurrent therapy, and there was a very high rate of skin toxicity. Now, one of the reasons why we picked paclitaxel for the protocol that we were doing is that when you have a woman with locally recurrent dermal disease, there are plenty of women who will actually be progressing through treatment and developing new sites elsewhere as we're doing the treatment on its own. Paclitaxel tends to be the most one of the most sensitive and active agents in breast cancer. And at least for our trial, we wanted to pick one that A, was not going to break the bank for patients and was going to get approved for, and B, really just trying to take advantage of the fact that the radiation is a little bit substandard because they've previously had radiation. We're not able to completely encompass the whole chest wall. We're specifically trying to avoid that area that's going to pose them at a higher risk for late complications. So trying to make up for a little bit of lost ground with the radiation. And then at least for the time being, even women with node-positive disease, you know, outcomes are still fairly favorable when we can get 12 cycles of paclitaxel before we begin radiation. So I'm not sure if I think that's going to change.
Thank you.
You're welcome.